Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Yes. This is the day that the Lord hath made. Yes. We are rejoicing and we are glad in it. Welcome to the live stream of Grace Church International. Welcome to our revival service on tonight. We are grateful to be in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. We are excited about what God has done, what God is doing, and what God will do in this historical time. We know that God has shown himself strong on behalf of his people. We have been in a 21-day consecration today. It's day 15 of our 21 days of prayer and fasting and consecrating here through our New Year's revival consecration. If you've been missing out on our 6 a.m. morning prayer, I want you to know you're missing out on an anointed time. You're missing out on an opportunity to touch heaven. We have been touching heaven through our prayers in our morning time at 6 a.m. We have been coming into the house on Wednesday evenings, every Wednesday this month, in prayer and praise and in preaching. And on Sunday mornings, our bishop has been preaching and leading us in this season. And I don't know about you, but I feel God moving in the lives of his people. I don't know about you, but I feel him moving in my life. I feel God doing something new in this season. We're grateful that those that are planted in the house of the Lord are flourishing in the courts of our God, and we are flourishing in this season. Listen, our worship team is coming tonight to lead us in worship. We have a preacher in the house tonight. Our bishop is here tonight. There's a few of us in the sanctuary facilitating worship on tonight. But I know that wherever you are, whether you're at home, whether you're in a hospital room, whether you're at work, wherever you are right now, if you're even maybe sitting in your car somewhere watching this live stream or worshiping with us tonight, we send the Spirit of the Lord right to where you are. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And I declare tonight that we have liberty to do what God has called us to do. We have liberty to worship. We have liberty to touch heaven on tonight in our prayers and in the preaching and the proclamation of the Word of God. Won't you receive our worship leader now as we come and go into the presence of the Lord together? Amen.
Come on, you know this church, so we sing.
Lord, I'm amazed by you.
Yeah.
And all of the things you do. And all the power in your name. The heavens declare your glory. The angels, they bow before thee. Let all creation shout and proclaim. Yeah, that you are great. You are great and mighty. And all of the things you do. And
come on, lift your voice.
The heavens declare your glory.
Yeah.
And the angels, they bow before thee.
You are great.
You are great.
One more time from the top. Every voice.
Sing, Lord, I'm amazed, yeah.
Lord, I'm amazed by you.
And all the things. The heavens declare your glory.
Heavens declare
your glory. And the angels, they bow before thee.
Bow before thee.
Let all creation,
let
yeah.
All creation,
that's all of us here again.
Shout and proclaim.
Yeah. Sing, you are the great saint.
You are the great.
Yeah. Sing, you. As we say, as we sing your great name, yeah, to our great and mighty God. So we sing hallelujah,
glory
to you, hallelujah, to our great. You are the great and mighty God. You are the great. You are the great and mighty.
Come on, one voice, everybody sing.
Sing, you are
the great.
Sing, you are. There's nobody like you, Jesus. There's nobody like you, Lord.
You are great.
Oh,
you are great. Mighty.
One more time, sing, you are the great.
You are great.
You are the great.
You are great. Mighty God.
Sing, you are the
great.
You're great and greatly to be praised.
You are great and mighty God.
Now come on, everywhere that you are, just begin to lift your hands and lift your hearts to the Lord in this moment. Come on. Come on, release your worship in this place. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. The name of the Lord is worthy of our praise. So we sing our songs to you this evening, Lord. Because you are so great and greatly to be praised. You're great and greatly to be praised. Our ways are not your ways, no. Your thoughts are higher, your ways are higher. Everything about you is better, Lord, yeah. Last time I hear, because you are the great. You are, say, you are the great. Come on, one more time, sing it out.
So you are a great,
you are great.
With all the conviction we have, we sing.
You are great.
This is our declaration, oh God, forever and always, forever and always, forever and always, forever and always.
You are great.
Come on, last time, make this your confession.
So you are
great.
There's no one like you in all the earth.
You are great.
No one in this universe compares to your worth, Lord.
You are great.
You're holy, you're worthy, you're righteous, yes.
Well, that's our testimony today. Just release your worship in this place. Just release your worship in this place.
God, we bless you. Lord, we lift you high.
We declare that there is no one like you in all the earth, God. We declare that you are worthy of all praise, that you are worthy of glory and honor and adoration. So we set our eyes on you today.
Say, you give life,
you give life.
You are love,
you are love.
Bring
light to the
dark. You give hope,
you give
hope. You
restore,
every
heart that is broken.
We sing, great are you, Lord, say,
great are you, Lord.
Come on, one voice, sing it out.
It's your breath.
It's your breath.
Come on and sing. You give hope, you restore
every heart.
One more time, say. You give life, you are love, you bring light. Oh, you give hope, you restore every heart. So we sing, great are you.
Wherever you are, just release your worship in this place. We sing our song of praise to you. Oh, you're so worthy, Lord. Oh, and all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Our hearts will cry.
Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
So we sing, great are you.
Are you, Lord?
Yeah. Oh, sing all the earth.
All the earth will
come on and prophesy at church. Our hearts will cry.
Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
So we sing, great are you, Lord. Your face,
our hearts will cry.
So we sing, great are you, Lord, are you, Lord? Oh, and oh, sing all the earth.
Yeah,
our hearts will cry. Whoa, so we sing, great.
Oh,
or break.
Our hearts will cry even.
Come on, this is our confession today. Hey. Are you Lord?
Everybody, lift up your voice and worship him. Come on with the breath that you have in your body. Come on with the fruit of your lips, bless him. Come on with the lifting of your hands, honor him. Come on and give him praise today. Glorify him, magnify him. He's worthy of the praise. He's worthy of the honor. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of our God is worthy. The name of our God is worthy. Worthy to be praised. Come on, church. Come on and glorify him. Come on and bless his name. He's great and greatly to be praised. We ought to glorify him. We ought to magnify him. We ought to honor him today. Come on, everybody, tell him. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour
out our praise. Pour out our praise.
It's your breath. For all of your praise today, you ought to wet the floor with your tears. You ought to wipe his feet with your hair today. Come on and worship him today. Hallelujah. He's great. He's great. He's great. He's great. He's great. He's great. Come on. He's great. He's great. He's marvelous. He's omnipotent. Come on and glorify him.
You are.
He's the only one worthy of our praise, the only one worthy of our worship. He is the object of our desire tonight. He is comely. He is beautiful for every situation. Come on, you ought to worship Him tonight. You ought to worship Him tonight, right where you are. Lift those hands right where you are. Listen, one of the privileges that we have in worship and praise to our God is the privilege of coming to God in prayer. The hymn writer said, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, all of our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Then the hymn writer said, oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pains we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. One of the privileges that we have today is not only to worship Him in our song, but to pour out on Him in prayer. I'm reminded of the woman Hannah when she went into the temple, and the Bible says she poured out on Him. She poured out her prayer. She poured out her complaint to the Lord. And the Lord heard her and answered her. And tonight, as Minister Rebecca comes to lead us in prayer, let us come to the throne of grace boldly, that we might find favor and help in our time of need. For the God that we pray to is not a dead God. The God that we pray to is the God that answers by fire. The God that we pray to, His hand is not too short to save. His ear is not too heavy that He can't hear. Our God is concerned about every one of our needs, and He desires that we bring the smallest of these to Him in prayer. Come now, as Minister Rebecca leads us to the throne of grace.
The Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad. The Lord reigns. Let GCI be glad in Him tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we humble ourselves in Your presence. We are assembled here to bless Your holy name with everything that is within us, Lord. We invite Your Lord Jesus Christ to take Your place on the throne of our hearts, on our lips and on our tongues as we part them, God, to give You the praise You certainly deserve. We lift our hands in submission, for not our will, God, but Thy will be done. Father, hear our prayer tonight. We ask of You, Holy Spirit, to lead us to the rock that is higher than us. For You're not overwhelmed, Lord God. For You don't slumber nor sleep. And You can handle everything we place in Your hands. For You are that rock. Blessed be the God of our salvation. You are our fortress, Lord, our shield and our strong tower. No matter who is in power on the earth temporarily, our eyes are as doves, firmly fixed on You, our God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Lord, You have laid a foundation in Zion, a stone tested and precious, a sure foundation. In You, our hope is sure, and our future is certain, for we are citizens of heaven. You are the rock upon which we lean, depend, and stand. You are our firm foundation. Blessed be the God of our salvation. You are our fortress, shield, and strong tower. Abba, Father, we draw nigh unto You tonight. Come, Holy Spirit, be ever present in our midst. Our expectation is of You. We wait on You, therefore our strength is renewed. We mount up with wings like eagles. We are able to move swiftly, for we are above in a place of safety, power, and stability. We run the race that You have set before us this year, and we shall not be weary. We walk the path that You lay out for us, and we will not faint, because it is Your power and it is Your Spirit that sustains us. Just as eagles rise above chaos and turbulence, so we rise in you, seeing in advance the things you desire to show us. The night is yours, so we sing to you, we dance with you, and we glean from your living word through your servant. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, and we give you thanks. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord forever and forever. I know you feel the presence of God where you are. I sense God's power and presence moving in the midst of us. And I'm grateful this evening for the presence of God and the anointing of the Spirit that I sense in this hour. I'm grateful to you for your viewership. I'm Bishop Jonathan Alvarado, and you've tuned into the live stream of Grace Church International. And you've caught us, amen. You've caught us on a good night. You've caught us on the night of one of the nights of our New Year's revival. And we're excited tonight because the Spirit of the Lord is present in the sanctuary. Somebody here, give him glory and honor and praise. Will you do it? I'm so grateful for my teammates that have served on tonight. Brother Jonathan Alvarado II, who's led us in worship. This team of singers and musicians that have ministered unto the Lord, played instruments skillfully unto the Lord. Our technical team that is facilitating the live stream and the live sound and the like. My concelebrants of liturgy that are here on tonight serving, not the least of which is in the person of our co-pastor, Dr. Tony Alvarado. Y'all help me salute and celebrate our co-pastor. Amen, amen, and amen. I'm so grateful for each and every one of you. We got our hospitality team coupled with our health ministry team, so that way anybody that comes in here to serve is coming in here in the right way. The church is closed, but we had Nicodemus always slides in here by night and want to make sure they can get, so they masked up and temperatured up and all those things and signed up and everything. So we're grateful to the Lord for this opportunity that we have. I want to move swiftly because I want to get us to the season of hearing the word of the Lord from this great man of God, whom I'll introduce in just a moment. But I want you to join with me in an evening sacrifice on tonight. We've been receiving a consecration offering for our 21 days of fasting and consecration. I've asked at least 200 of our saints every time we've gathered together to give $21 on these Wednesday nights in the month of January. Will you join me on tonight with at least a $21 seed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? I want to encourage the people of God to give liberally, to give lavishly, to give cheerfully in the house of the Lord on tonight. Make it your priority. Make it your business not only to like, not only to subscribe if you've not subscribed to our YouTube channel, not only to like if you're on Facebook, not only to tag your friends and to share so that way other people can get in on this worship service right here at this moment of giving, right before the season of ministry in the word. But I want to encourage you not only to do all those things, but to give. To give tonight, and if you haven't presented your tithe, if you weren't here on Sunday and you want to bring the Lord your tithe, do so on tonight. Do so on tonight. If you were here on Sunday, with us on Sunday, and you presented your tithe, bring the Lord an offering on tonight. I've asked for a particular amount. I'm asking the people of God to join me at that level of giving. And if you do, I believe God will bless your life. Not only in tithes and offerings, but we also give in Episcopal support while on others. Thou art calling. Do not pass me by. It seems like when I don't emphasize Episcopal support, y'all forget about me, though I'm standing up here in the one raising the offering. So will y'all please make sure that you give an Episcopal support on tonight in Jesus' name. Make sure that you do that and make up for what you didn't do on Sunday. Some of y'all didn't do nothing on Sunday. Make sure, make up for what you didn't do on Sunday in Jesus' name. I'm so grateful to each and every one of you. Listen, we've been in a tremendous season of prayer. Prayer every morning at 6 o'clock has been incredible. It's been powerful. It's been anointed. It's been overwhelming. And if you're missing out on the prayer call, the information is on our website. The information that goes out by push notification. You can tap into the prayer for the next, what we got? We got 6 more days of prayer. After this morning, we got 6 more days. We're on day 15 of consecutive prayer during our prayer and fasting and consecration. I want to encourage you, meet us every morning at 6 a.m. for a season of prayer. Start your day off in the presence of the Lord, in the company of the saints, and in prayer. It'll do you good. Make sure that you join us there. I've been so encouraged by the prayers that have been being prayed, and they've been blessing my life and encouraging my spirit, and we've been bombarding heaven every morning at 6 a.m., and I am particularly grateful for the prayers that have been prayed for my mother and my mother-in-law. I want you to keep on praying along that wise, Mother Margaret Baker.
Baker and Mother Dolores Alvarado, I want you to keep on lifting up my mother, Pastor Tony's mother, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But we are managing in this sandwich season of life where we're getting our kids into the young adult years, and while at the same time we're trying to help our elderly parents. And so I thank you for your prayers as we manage this season of life. I'm grateful as I'm traveling back and forth between Atlanta and Columbus, Ohio, now Circleville, Ohio. I'm grateful for every one of your prayers, your kind thoughts, and your gestures towards your bishop. I'll be taking off again this week. Got to go see about my mama. I got to lay eyes on her. You know, I'm getting old myself, and y'all know how the old folk used to say, come over here, I just want to look at you. That's the way I feel about my mama now. I just need to go up there and look at her. And so she was hospitalized earlier this week, and by God's grace, she is back at home, and so I'm thankful to the Lord for that, but I'm going up there to look at her. It's not that I don't trust my older brother to take care of her, but I need to look at her, my doggone self. So y'all just pray for me as I get up and down these highways to go see about my mama in Jesus' name. All right? All right, good. Are you giving? Tell me what we're doing. Tell me what we need to do here. Do I have some? I mean, I could always put me in the key of F. I could always sing. And y'all better be able to sing with me. Now these young people, Hodges, these young people, they don't know the songs, I know. But y'all better know this. I'm so glad I got my feet on the rock. I'm not sad. I got my feet on the rock. Satan's mad. I got my feet on the rock. Tuesday, Jesus Christ, the silent rock. Y'all say with me, I'm so glad. Got my feet
on the rock.
Y'all better learn the whole song. I'm not sad. This is on my third album. This is on my third album. You need to know my music.
Got my feet on the rock.
Tuesday,
Jesus
Christ, the solid rock. Keep your feet.
Your feet on the rock.
Say no matter what, no.
No matter what.
Keep your
keep
feet.
Your feet on the rock.
Keep looking up.
Keep your
feet.
Keep your feet on the rock.
To stay.
Jesus Christ.
The solid rock.
Solid
rock. Don't give up. Say don't give up.
Keep your feet.
Keep your feet
on the rock.
Say no matter what.
Keep looking up.
Keep
your feet on the rock.
To stay. Jesus
Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
The stone that the builders rejected has become. Always makes a way for me. And he always brings me through. I love to call his name. Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
What's his name?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Call his name.
Jesus Christ.
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 The solid rock.
Solid rock.
Now clap your hands, everybody, and give Jesus praise. You may retire your stations in Jesus' name. Thank you so much. I'm so grateful tonight for the presence of a friend and a brother, a gift to the body of Christ, and a preacher par excellence. This preacher I've known, his pastor, has been in relationship with Pastor Tony and I since the mid-1990s. The older that I get, the more I value relationships not of convenience, not relationships that are transactional, but relationships that span the decades, recognizing that friendship is a gift from God. The Bible says that a friend loves at all times. And a brother is born for adversity. You don't know that you have a friend till you go through something. You don't know you have brothers and sisters until you look up one day on the other side of calamity to see who's standing with you. And for coming up on 3 decades now, this man of God has been a friend and a brother. His preaching gift speaks for itself. His pastoral prowess is remarkable. His character is unassailable. And who he is to the body of Christ, it doth not yet appear, because his best days are yet ahead of him. Bishop Brian Keith Hodges is not only a preacher and a pastor, but he's an educated man. He's earned his bona fide in the academic arena, from an associate's degree to a bachelor's degree at Beulah Heights University, and a Master of Arts degree and a Doctor of Education Ministry at Columbia Theological Seminary. He went over there and fought with the Presbyterians and came out unscathed. Hallelujah. He serves not only as the senior pastor and establishmentarian of Gathering of Champions Church International, but he also serves as the chair of the Division of Religious Studies at Beulah Heights University, right here in the city of Atlanta, the oldest Pentecostal-based Bible college and university in the Southeast. I am grateful to the Lord for his life, for his episcopacy, as a bishop in the Lord's church, serving the Lord in various and sundry stations. And I believe that he has the word of the Lord in his mouth for us on tonight. I would that our musicians just play just softly under, as he'll come in his own way, but I want us to prepare a meditative moment for him to come and to deliver the word of the Lord unto us, that we might know and hear and perceive what the Spirit is saying to the church. Lord, grant us eyes to see. Grant us ears to hear. Grant us hearts to receive all that you would say to Grace Church and all those in attendance on tonight, from near and from far, what thus saith the Lord tonight. The entrance of your word brings light. It gives understanding to the simple. I love you, Lord. Your word is sweeter than honey in the honeycomb. Oh, the Lord is perfect. It converts the soul. I pray tonight that you use your servant, Bishop Brian Keith Hodges, to deliver unto us the word of the Lord. Receive him now in Jesus' name.
In just a moment, I'm going to invite you, in the practice of my church, to clap your hands. But before you do it, I want you to pretend like God was standing right in front of you. How would you clap your hands? How would you clap your hands if the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords was standing right in front of you? How would you clap your hands if the one who hears and answers prayers was standing right in front of you? How would you clap your hands if the one that got you out of the car accident was standing right in front of you? How would you clap your hands without a paycheck, you hadn't missed a meal or a bill? How would you? I know that we're in a touchless world. So I'm going to invite you to do one thing. Would you just find a neighbor, gaze at them, look at them, look at them. You and just one person, look at them. Everybody get one person. Stare right at them. Wave at that neighbor, wave at that neighbor, wave at that neighbor. Ask that neighbor. Ask that neighbor. Say, neighbor, can you see me? Answer them. Can you hear me, neighbor? Answer them. You sure you can see me? Answer them. Now tell them that means the devil missed again this week. Wrong neighbor. Find you a different neighbor. Wave at him. Make contact. Wave at him. Say, can you see me, neighbor? Answer them. Can you hear me, neighbor? Answer them. You sure you can see me, neighbor? Say, neighbor, the devil did try, but God blocked him one more week. God blocked him one more week. Hallelujah. Okay, find one more neighbor. Wave at him. Say, neighbor, you can see me, can't you? Could I testify for myself? I'm still here. Still got my joy. Still in my right mind. Still praising God. Still full of the Holy Ghost. Still walking in righteousness. Would you take that same exuberance? Would you take that same joy and join me as we thank God for his favorite son and daughter, Bishop Jonathan Alvarado and Dr. Tony Alvarado. What an incredible gift to the body of Christ, this dynamic duo who continues to do world-class ministry right in Atlanta, Georgia. Let me testify a truth to you. They didn't have to stay in Atlanta. God could have sent them anywhere in the world and they would have been well received, well respected, well revered, and well regarded. But the Lord left them right here in Atlanta, Georgia, so that we might be encouraged by their witness. We might be edified by their proclamation. We might be inspired by their high paradigm and incredible model, and that we would continue to worship him as they lead us so dynamically. I listened to Sis tonight, and Sis still got it. Good gracious. She's, woo, if got it, you sure still got it. Good Lord. And Bishop, incredible. We're blessed tonight for them. Would you join me in an honor of deep appreciation? Let's thank God for them one more time. And not just them, but the son and the daughter. Oh, grace. Man, you were phenomenal tonight. What a great gift. The praise team, amazing tonight. I'm thankful to have Dr. Brandon Isaac McCray, who tagged along tonight, and Benjamin and Vernon. And in the next few minutes of your precious time that I have that I do not take for granted, would you open your Bibles, please, ladies and gentlemen, to Luke 18 and drop your eyes down to verse number 9. Luke 18. Verse number 9, Luke 18. You have it, say amen. The English Standard Version is my favorite translation. It's the one I'd like to read from tonight. Luke 18, verse number 9. He also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves, that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Verse 10, two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbles himself will be exalted. Amen. Pictures, prayers, and proclamations. If you'll just look at a neighbor and say, oh neighbor, see the pictures, hear the prayers, wait on the proclamation. You can be seated. Lord, help us tonight. Amen. I preached my first sermon at the Burnett Baptist Church in Detroit, Michigan, the 18th day of August, 1991. A year prior, I was standing in the church office and a bright, seemingly intelligent young man walks in and the office lit up and they engaged him for about an hour. Finally, the church secretary, Bernice Townsend, said, "Reverend Myatt, this is young Brother Hodges. In a year, he'll preach his first sermon. You should get to know him." I was just ecstatic that I saw a young man who was going to preach, who was preaching the gospel and pastoring, and who could form a relationship with me. I was ecstatic, eager to hear whatever he might have to say or offer. The young man said, young Minister Hodges, Brother Hodges, walk with me out to my car." And as we walked out to his car, he said, "I'm gonna give you the best advice that I can give you, and I'll give it to you right now." I said, "Hang on, let me grab a pad and a pen." He said, "You won't need it." He says, "It's really very simple." I said, "Go." He said, "Every day I want you to pray this prayer." He says, "It's a simple prayer. You don't have to write it down. You don't have to do anything to memorize it. It's simple. It'll flow out of your own experience with God." "Okay, shoot. What's the prayer?" He says, "It's only got 5 words in it." I said, "Okay, tell me. I can't wait. Give me. Don't keep me in suspense. Give me the prayer." He said, "Pray every day, Lord, save me from myself." For the last 30 years, it's been the prayer that I pray every day. "Lord, save me from myself." Because what I've discovered about myself is I can get me in trouble that the devil can get me in. What I've discovered about myself is I'm drawn away by things that the devil sometimes has nothing to do, and that in my own issues, in my own struggles, if God doesn't save me from myself, I can mess up everything that God might have for myself. "Lord, save me from myself." It is this prayer that is an issuance of utter humility that this text seems to indicate one should have when they live their lives, that we should live lives of humility. We should be people who seek not to be seen, but seek to experience God and others in a way that benefits us and blesses the kingdom. It is in our humility that we should discover the richness of God's plans for our life. But often it is in our arrogance, and you'll see it in a minute, it's in our arrogance that we miss the thing that God has for us. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, these pictures, these prayers, and these proclamations, I pray, will serve as an inspiration to you. And I challenge you to reread this passage, all of chapter 18, in your devotional time so that you might enliven what you hear tonight. Let me suggest first that there are 3 pictures in this text that I want you to see. The first picture in this text that I want you to see is a picture of arrogance. How do we know that it is a picture of arrogance? Because we see very clearly that there is this issuance of self-aggrandizement. Jesus's words are clear, they're explicit. Who trusted in themselves. There are people who trust in themselves. Surely we know that we can do nothing on our own or in and of ourselves. Have God not given us strength and capacity and ability, we would not be able to do anything. There are people who will watch this live. There are people who are sitting in this sanctuary, and you need to know that whatever you have, God provided it for you. Whoever you are, wherever you have attained or ascended in life, it was God who did it for you. You did not do it yourself. Truly, you
you have to know that there are people who are smarter than you, more gifted than you, have more talent than you, have more ability than you, and yet God still chose you. You missed a good place to holler amen, but because I'm a kind evangelist, I'm going to throw it back at you. There's no reason or space for anybody to be arrogant or self-aggrandized, and the reason there's no room for it is because God did it all for you. Let me testify. I'm the last of eight. God picked over seven others and chose me. And not only did he choose me, he decided to choose me not because I was smarter or better, but he chose me because he loved me. And not only does he loved me enough to look beyond my faults and still decide to use me. You don't have to testify, but I'll testify tonight. If I had to pick somebody, it wouldn't be me. If I had to recommend somebody, it wouldn't be me. If I had to suggest somebody for the job, it wouldn't be me. But thanks be to God that he does not look like we look. I love scripture. Scripture reminds us that when Samuel went down to Jesse the Bethlehemite's house, the first young man that came out, he said, surely this is the one. God leans over the balcony of heaven and taps him on the shoulder, and he issues that verse that we all love. He simply says, man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. I'm preaching to somebody here today that could just testify, I don't deserve what I have. I don't deserve where I am. I don't deserve what's happened to me. Thanks be to God for doing it anyway. It's the picture of arrogance. Let me argue, friends. It's the picture of arrogance, self-aggrandizement, those who trusted in themselves. But watch what happens when you are drunk with your own image and drunk with your own belief and you read your own press. Self-aggrandizement will always show up in scorn. Watch the text. The text says this, and treated others with contempt. It's only the arrogant that don't treat people fairly. It's only the arrogant that don't treat them with love, value, and dignity, the dignity of humanity. The truth is, all of us are deserving of high valuation and appraisal. We should look at people not for where they are and not for what they have, but we should see beyond the veneers of their current context and see them where they're going tomorrow. Let me pause here, if you don't mind, Bishop, and argue this for a minute. Sometimes we are judged based on where we are, and people forget to realize that we are just here because we have to be for now. Don't ever judge somebody who's at a position or tether them to the place where you meet them. God's got something bigger and better for all of us. I don't know, but maybe I'm preaching to somebody tonight who understands a simple truth, and that's this. Where I am is not where I'll be for the rest of my life. Y'all missed another good place to holler. You ought to wave at somebody and tell them, where I am is not where I'll be for the rest of my life. This is service. This is duty. This is honor. Don't you judge me based on where I'm at right now. Don't tether me to this position, because I've got something that still has not been manifested. There's potential inside of me. There's possibility yet unborn. There's capacity yet undeveloped. There's skill set and talent that still has not manifested yet. God, y'all missed another good place to holler. Let's try it together. Wave at that neighbor one more time and say, you have no idea what's getting ready to happen to you. You have no idea what's getting ready to manifest. You have no idea what's getting ready to come through the annals of your life. Something amazing is getting ready to happen to you. I know what it is. You waved at the wrong person. You better find you a different neighbor and wave like you're going to lose your mind and say, something amazing is getting ready to come your way, show up in your life, manifest, getting ready to come in your direction, getting ready to happen in your life, getting ready to have an accident in your life, getting ready to show up in ways you've never imagined. God's got something better for you. God's got something better for you. God's got something better for you. And watch this, friends. When you're arrogant, self-aggrandizement is important to you. But what follows self-aggrandizement is scorn. Scorn. Be careful. Because Jesus, in his parabolic expression, pointed out very clearly one man's arrogance was his focus on himself and his disrespect to others. Don't miss this. That I don't care who gets elected, don't you get puffed up. Because I want to assure you that God knows how to pull you down. if you ever get to the place where you feel like you're better than everybody else. Not only do I want to suggest for you a picture of arrogance, but I want to show you the foolishness of arrogance in this second picture, and it's a picture of an appeal, because the text says that both of them went up to the temple probably at the hour of prayer, which means no matter which is a high and the other low, which is spiritual and which the other one is sinful, in either case both of them had to go up to pray. You missed it. Let me throw it back at you. Don't you ever get to the point where you believe because you've got some bumps and bruises in your life that you're less than everybody else. All of us need prayer. Can I just throw it back at you one more time? All of us need prayer. You missed it. You missed your place to receive it. All of us need prayer. Go back to March 1st, 2020, and if you don't believe we need prayer, take a look at the events that took place in America. Doesn't matter if you're spiritual or not. On that day, all of us need prayer. All of us need prayer. They both showed up. It's their appearance, and their appeal is an appearance. Watch the appearance. They both went to the temple, and then watch the activity. They both went to the temple to pray. Don't ever forget that whatever station in life you have, you have to learn how to pray. Let me suggest to you, friends, that prayer is not just the lifeblood of the church. Prayer is the lifeblood of the believer. If a believer does not pray, that believer will cease to exist. They both made an appeal, but then, thirdly, here's a third picture. They both have a picture here of this account. One man goes in high, but he leaves low. One man goes in low, but he leaves high. Get this, if you're not careful, you can be so arrogant that when you leave the place of prayer, you leave jilted. But then there are others who will leave the place of prayer justified. Hey, I want to argue to somebody that if you're not careful, you will let your years of experience in church overrule your ability to see the sensitivity of the Spirit in your life. Don't get so careless that you miss the fact that we're all in this thing together. Dr. Tony, a man was at our church preaching. He made an altar call. He said, anybody need prayer? Come to the altar. I walked to the altar. A few months later, somebody else was preaching. They said, anybody need prayer? I came to the altar. A few months later, one of our associates was ministering. They said, anybody need prayer? And I came to the altar. Finally, somebody said, Bishop, I just want to know, what's going on with you that you keep needing prayer? I said, well, prayer's kind of like currency, because if that person would have asked me if I needed $100, I'd have walked to the altar. And so since I would have walked to the altar for money, I need to go to the altar for something that's worth well more than money. So I'm going to go. I don't care who praying. If you're praying, count me in. The imagery we need to jettison in the church, and that is you only come to the altar because you got a problem. No, friend, if you're praying and you're praying to Jesus, I'm going to be at the altar. Let me suggest now, after three pictures, I want to suggest three focuses on prayer. Three focuses on prayer. Three focuses on prayer. Three focuses on prayer. Let me argue, friends, that if you're not careful, you will devalue prayer because you have a misunderstanding of prayer. Prayer is not just communication with God, but prayer is also connection with God. Some of you who are a little bit younger than me, I'm a little closer to 50 than I am to 40, and I'll tell you this, before we had high speed, we had dial-up. And when you would first click to get on the internet, you would hear a series of sounds, you would hear some clicking, and then there'd be a dialogue box at the bottom of the screen that says, you are now connected. When you pray, you instantly connect with God. Boy, you missed another good place to holler. When you pray, you instantly connect with God. It doesn't matter if you pray here or pray at your house, pray in a prayer closet, pray in a public space, pray at your cubicle or at your desk, pray at your workstation. Whenever you pray, you instantly connect with God. Prayer is not just communication with God. It's not just connection to God. But there's a third piece, Dr. Tony, that we should see, and that is prayer is communion with God. God never lets you pray and not envelop you in the prayer. God wraps us up when we pray. Hallelujah. He wraps us up when we pray. Because prayer is not just communication. It's not just connection. It's also communion. We get to fellowship with God when we pray. Now then, let's look at three focuses on prayers. Here's the first one. There's a prayer that is prayed with no dependence on God. How can you pray and have no dependence on God when you pray? I am befuddled. My mind is stretched theologically, ideologically, philosophically. I can't get it. How do you pray like this Pharisee? No dependence on God. He prays, and that's the arrogance which takes his prayer, removes his dependence on God. Watch now. Look at his prayer. He is thankful for who he is not like, which means he is ruthless. He is thoughtless about how he lives, which means he is heartless. He is trifling in his service to God, which means he's faithless. Don't miss this. Don't miss this, friends, that you should never pray a prayer saying to the Lord, I'm glad I'm not like somebody else. He has us in the school of prayer, this Pharisee does, and he teaches us how not to pray. Hear it, that our prayer should not ever focus on somebody else and the avoidance of what they have experienced or encountered. Because the truth is, God has made you the woman that you are by the stuff that happened to you. Let me try that one more time. You are the man you are. You are the woman that you are because of the stuff that happened to you. As a matter of fact, your story is the kind of story that we need to hear so that we can see the capacity of God in real time in your life. The truth is, God didn't have to save you from your drug use. He didn't have to save you from your abusive relationship. He didn't have to save you from your untoward behaviors or practices, but he did save you from all of those things. Y'all don't want to testify, but the truth is, all of us are at something, and if it had not been for God saving us, it would have taken us away. So now when we pray prayers of thanksgiving to a God who saved us in our mess and despite of our mess, beyond our mess, and is helping us use our mess as a tool for ministry. I wish I could condemn somebody, but the truth is I can't, because I've got too many strikes in my own life. I've got too many things that I've done that the Lord had to rescue me out of. Let me just tell the truth. Most of the stuff I've been in has been easy to get in and hard to get out of. But every time I got in something, because God wanted to use me, he always brought me out of the thing that I got myself in and reminded me that you can never look down on anybody, because if I didn't do it for you, you'll be messed up for the rest of your life. You missed your place to holler. Let me try it right quick. Anybody in here just want to lift your hands up right quick and tell the Lord, thank you for what you got me out of. I'll give you 30 seconds. I'll give you 15. Take 15 seconds and just thank him for what he got you out of. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for what you. me out of. Thank you for what you got me out of. Thank you for what you got me out of. Let's turn that over. Let's turn that coin over. Lord, thank you for what you never let me get into. Thank you that there were some things I wanted to get into, but you stood between me and that. This Pharisee has a prayer with no dependence on God. This prayer that has no dependence on God is a prayer that is ruthless, heartless, and faithless. But let me show you the second thing. Watch this, friends. A prayer with an honest disposition. Watch the tax collector's prayer. The tax collector's prayer is a prayer that focuses on his broken posture. When you realize the gravity of your own humanity, when you realize the issues of your own iniquity, your own transgression, and your own sin, you find yourself in a posture of desperation. God, hear this prayer, because I make myself sick. God, hear this prayer, because I'm angry with myself. God, hear this prayer, because I'm tired of struggling with the same old stuff. God, hear this prayer, because I'm my own enemy. God, hear this prayer, because I'm my own problem. God, hear this prayer, because I caused my own aggravation. It's a prayer. It's a prayer of desperation. But this prayer of desperation is not a prayer that is focused on the accoutrements of life. He ain't saying, Lord, I'm praying because I need you to pay my bills. He's saying, Lord, I'm praying because I need you to help me deal with me. Then look at his bitter practice, y'all, his practice. He's disgusted at himself. When you reread the text, you'll see the high places and the low places of this man's prayer. Lastly, his plea is decisive because this man needs deliverance. God, help me with me. Well, now I want to suggest that until we are willing to ask God to help us with ourselves, we are going to live in a deceptive existence. That deceptive existence is to believe that something is wrong with everybody else and not us. It's a deceptive existence that we spend our time praying about how people are treating us and forget what we did to precipitate their treatment. It's a deceptive existence to always pray, every time I get a job, it's the people on my job that don't like me. Maybe it's not them. We are deceived. We are drunk. We are inebriated in our imagery of ourselves. Everybody, every time I get a job, they hate me. Maybe it ain't them. Maybe you ain't done the, maybe you've done no work on yourself. Maybe you've not wrestled with your own issues, the ones that you keep pacifying yourself, because it's easier to pacify than it is to confront. Here's the third thing I want to show you about prayer. Prayer and divine intervention. If you look at Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 8, here's what you'll find. You'll find prayer and intervention. Jesus starts with this whole notion of man ought always pray and not lose heart or not faint. He is not talking about continuous prayer, because continuous prayer would never end. He's talking about continual prayer, because continual prayer means you are consistent in your prayer. Watch this, y'all. That we should pray and not lose heart. In other words, we should pray and find prayer as our normative default. Default. The needle of my heart, Bishop Alvarado, was moved a few years ago when a lady in our church came up to me and she said she was going through a medical condition. And the needle of my heart, my pastoral theology was moved because I said to her, I would pray for her. And the Lord says, with the business of your life, you're going to forget that she's got a need. So I called her back and I said, let me pray for you right now. And from that day to this one, if you tell me you got an issue, I'm going to pray for you right then. But not just then. I'm going to keep praying for you until you tell me to stop. God had to train me to be an intercessor and to pray for others because I kept saying it as a part of my badge as a pastor. Come on, we say stuff that we don't really mean. I'm praying for you. Well, you forgot about them when they moved because somebody texted you or called your phone. God, help me to be honest enough that when I see a person in need, to pray for them. The prayer becomes the language of our lifeline, our lifestyle, and we pray. But watch this. If you look at verses 1 through 8, not only will you see continual prayer, you'll see the concession of prayer. God will give anybody who prays an answer. God's concession in prayer is if you pray, you get it. Let me just run through a few just to prove my case about my good theology tonight, Bishop Alvarado. Whatsoever you desire, when you pray, believe you shall receive, and you shall have it. This is the confidence we have in him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we have the petitions that we ask. Whatever you ask in my name, I'll do it that the Father might be glorified. Here's a concession of prayer that most of us never see, the magnanimity of prayer, because we don't keep praying. I argue prayer tonight. Not just because it's your theme for the next 21 days. I argue prayer because the church has become anorexic and anemic spiritually because of prayerlessness. Watch the consummation of prayer. God will right the wrong when you pray. A lady takes her adversary to a judge, and the judge says, because I don't fear God or regard man, I will give her justice because she's worrying me. That's the consummation of prayer. God says, keep on praying it until you see me turn it around. But what's the concern of the prayer answerer? The concern of the prayer answerer is this: will I find faith on earth? Will I find people in the body of Christ that will pray with consistency and persistence? Will I find people? That's what Jesus said. Jesus said, look at this woman's faith. My concern, though, is will I find people who will go at prayer like this woman go at justice? Prayer is the thing. Let me close now. You've seen the story. You've heard it. You've heard the thesis. Let me conclude now with the synthesis. I want you to see three proclamations that come because of two men praying. That's it. Now take my seat. The first proclamation is a proclamation of justification. I love it. This man who beat his breast, this man who did not find himself worthy to be in God's space, God's place, God's presence. Jesus said he went down to his house justified. Here's the good news I love about God. When God sees what you do, he'll testify for you. There's another time in scripture that God testifies. Maybe some of you remember it. God testifies. Hebrew 11 records the act of testimony. His act of testimony was this: by faith, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice unto God than Cain, with which he obtained witness that he was righteous. Watch this. God testified of his gift. And while he is dead, he still speaks. Somebody tonight need to hear that when God justifies you, you don't need anybody else to. I wish we could have church right here. I wish we could just thank God for setting it right for you when nobody else could set it right for you. I wish we could thank God tonight for being able to reach into your situation and cause it to shift when nobody else believed you, when nobody else thought you were worthy, when nobody else believed that God could use you, when nobody else thought that God had ministry for you, when nobody else thought that God wanted to do something with your life. God spoke up for you. I wish tonight I had about 10 people in here and about 25 people watching online that'll just holler, thank you, God, for speaking up for me. Thank you, God, for testifying for me. Thank you, God, for justifying my existence. Thank you, God, for making sure my life turned out better than it did when I got here. man, Jesus said, goes down to his house justified. Justify, Latin. Justi, to make. Ficere, just. So to justify means to make just. If your enemy does not appreciate you, God knows how to make things right for you. Let me tell you why my soul is so happy. Because I've had some people that did not want me to have better, didn't want me to do better, didn't want me to be better, didn't want me to live better, didn't want to see my life improve. And God said, forget what they think. I'm going to bless you anyway. Here it is. I want to suggest to about 10 people that the Lord's going to make your life better no matter what they try to keep from you. God's going to make your life better. God's going to make your life better. Let me just have a minute here. God's going to make your life better. When people leave you, God's going to make your life better. When they refuse to affirm you, God's going to make your life better. When they decide that you ain't worth it, God's going to make your life better. When they see you at your lowest ebb, God's going to make your life better. Would you help me preach to a neighbor? Just wave at him and tell him, God's going to make your life better. I feel like having church now. Find one more neighbor and say, God's going to make your life. I'm sorry. Just wave at one more neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm over here waving at you because I want you to know God's getting ready to make your life better. You waved at the wrong neighbor. Would you wave at one more neighbor? Tell that neighbor God's getting ready to make your life. Excuse me, every now and then, I'd like to give you a point and an illustration. Let me give you a point and an illustration. How fast will God make my life better? In the 1960s, there was a sitcom, and the intro to that sitcom went like this. Let me tell you a story about a man named Jed, poor mountaineer belly, kept his family fed. Out one day, he was shooting at some food, and up from the ground came a bubbling crude, black gold, Texas tea. So the next thing you know, oh, Jed's a millionaire. Kidding folks say, Jed, move away from there. California is the place you ought to be, so they loaded up the truck and they moved to Beverly Hills, that is, movie stars and swimming pool. Here's all I want to tell you, that one night, he went to bed with nothing. The next day, he went to bed with everything. God's going to justify you. I'm sorry, but can I just hear y'all say it one more time? Just say, God's gonna justify. God's gonna justify you. God's gonna make sense of this mess. God's gonna make sense of this foolishness. God's gonna make sense of this drama. God's gonna make sense of this evil. God's gonna make sense of this craziness. God's gonna. Of justification, but then there's a proclamation of judgment. Watch the judgment. Judgment is a man goes up to pray, but he goes down unfulfilled. He goes up to pray, but he leaves unfulfilled. When God judges you, he rips from you your fulfillment. So now you said the words, but you couldn't feel the presence. You said the words, but you could not experience the grace. You said the words, but you could not experience the mercy. You said the words, but you could not experience the power. Judgment. He missed his moment. Don't ever pray and miss your moment. Don't ever let prayer be an exercise and you don't receive from it the magnificent benefits of communion and fellowship with God. Don't miss your moment. Don't miss your moment. He left unfulfilled. But then he left unconscious. Unconscious. This man never experienced transformation that was happening as a result of the transaction. It's an interesting word in Latin. Unconscious. unconscious. The word conscious in Latin is really crazy. Con meaning with science knowledge. This man left without knowledge. Here's the tragedy. The tragedy is you can pray and be unconscious, which means you'll never know what God is saying or doing because you ain't aware. How do we pray with an abundance of activity, but we never hear from God? There's a generation where me and Bishop Alvarado and Dr. Tony come from. We have snow, and snow looks pretty, but it's awfully dangerous for two reasons. Number one, snow hides ice. And what happens when you get stuck on ice is you hit the accelerator. Your wheels spin, but your car don't go anywhere. I'm through, y'all. There's somebody in here. You've been praying, but ain't nothing been happening because you are unconscious and you don't realize that underneath all your stuff. I need more than the prayer wheels to be turning. I need some answers to be coming. This man leaves unfulfilled. This man leaves unconscious. This man leaves upended because he thought that for his praying, he would leave there justified. He left upended. He was made lower as to the lowest point near him. He stood up in arrogance and God lowered him and humbled him. I'm through now, friends. Watch God's divine justice. Only God can shift the perception of a thing. Never believe you are too low or bad or broken or blasted for God not to shift the perception. Came in low. Hey, come here, brother. I saw another brother. Come here, brother. Stay right there. Yeah. Stay right there. Stay right there. Stay right there. Yeah. Come here, brother. Uh-huh. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to get on your knees. And I want you to stand up. Keep standing. Lift your hands up. I need y'all to bury your hands in your face. Get as close as you can. Right? Now watch the picture. The picture in this story is the Pharisee and his arrogance. The other picture is humility. Watch what God does when God shifts perspectives. Could y'all stand up and lift y'all hands up, and can you fall on your face? That's what God does. I want you to know your enemy who's saying nothing's going to happen for you, God just. Hey, I want to ask y'all to do me a favor. When I say three, I want you to jump up out your seat. Three. I'm going to try it again. You were too slow. I told you I was going to do it. Sit down again. When I say three, I want you to jump up out of your seat. Three. That's how fast God's going to turn it around. Sit down again. Three. Sit down again. Three. Sit down again. Three. Sit down again. Three. Here's what I discovered. There's some of y'all on your way to sit down. Between the time you stopped praying and the time you started praying, God had already sent your answer. I wish I could get five people in here to wave at somebody and tell them already justified, already set right, already made in order, already put back together, already satisfied, already turned around, already shifted, already giving you back what you lost. Once you get prayer worked out, then you understand something about God, and that is that God has given you authority. Not only has he given you the keys of the kingdom, but he said to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. David Rinsberger was my New Testament professor at graduate school. And David Rinsberger said, y'all shouting on the wrong things. He said, this text
text has two shout points. The first one is that the text is written in future perfect tense, which means by the time you say it, it's already done. By the time you bind it, it's already done. He said, but the second thing that you need to hear is that this is a text that's a legal text that means law, which means that whatever you say is law becomes law, not only on earth but up in heaven, and whatever you say is no law is broken, not only on earth but up in heaven. Wave at a name and tell a name some things I get ready to shift for me. Wrong neighbor, find one more neighbor and tell them some things I get ready to shift for me. I apologize, Bishop, for running over, but let me say this. Dr. Tony, there's some people here in this room and watching live that are getting ready to bind some stuff to their lives. I'll lead you off, then I need you to go for your own. Let me start you by telling you that when you pray tonight, say to the Lord, I bind around myself the fact that I never need a paycheck. You missed your place. Try it right quick. I bind around myself that I never need a paycheck. And what just happened is God said, I'm doing it in heaven, that you'll never have to beg, borrow, or steal. Because from this moment on, whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Let's try one more. I'll be happy and filled with joy the rest of my life. I dare you to bind it around your life and watch God make it a law. I dare you to say, I'll always be discerning, and watch God bind it around your life. You who are justified got the authority to say stuff. We bound some stuff. Let's loose some stuff. I loose from me drama, foolishness, craziness, ignorant, silly, stupid, low down, trashy people. They are out of my life for the rest of my life, and I'm walking in health, hope, happiness, and wholeness. Here it is, and I'm through. The same thing that just happened in this room is what we call, in a natural context, a real-time transaction. I gave a lady my debit card. She swiped it for my purchase, and when she swiped it, before she could give me my receipt, the bank sent me a text saying, you are at this place and you just bought this item at this much. That's what the Lord said. Tell Grace tonight, you're at a place where it's happening in real time. Wave at a neighbor and say, neighbor, this is happening in real time. Yeah! Find one more neighbor. Say, neighbor, this is happening in real time. Yeah! This is happening in real time. It's happening. Wave at one more neighbor. Tell that neighbor this is happening in real time. Oh, it's happening.
You just point at one person. Point at one person. Say these words and I'm through. Say everything, everything that you've been believing for, everything you've been praying for, everything you've been fasting for is happening right now, right now, right now, right now, right now, right now. Everything y'all have prayed for. For 21 days is happening. I'ma quit this, but my soul got happy. My soul got happy. You pointed at the wrong neighbor. Pointed one more neighbor. Come here, lady. Right there, come here. Yeah, hurry, run down here. Run down, that one right there. Yep, that one, you. Come right quick, come right quick. I need you to point right at her and say everything, 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 right now, right now. No more waiting. The door just opened. Right now. Right now. Right now. I need you to point at her and say everything. Right now. Everything. I need you to point to Miss Spellman behind you and say everything. Right now. I need you to point to your sister and say everything. Dr. Tony, pray. Point for everything. 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 I need y'all to say it faster. Everything, 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 right now, right now, yes, right now, yeah, right now, ah, right now. Right now, right now, right now, right now. Okay, I just need 10 seconds, 10 seconds. I need you to look at a person and say, neighbor, forget what happened, because all of it just changed. Now, how you gonna praise them that all the stuff just changed? How you gonna praise them that the life you knew is now over? All things have passed away, and behold, all things have. They just. I dare you to spin around. I know this the virtual church. I know this the quarantine church. But I dare you to spin around right quick and say it just turned around. Yeah. It just. Could I tell you, could I tell them what I told you? You are the source. You are the source of my strength. I want your permission to tell them what I told you. Shortly after you asked me to come, I started praying out loud in my car, Lord, what is it that you want me to say? And the Lord last week brought you before me. And the Lord said, tell them, go, it's time now. It's time now. It's time now. Because you are a man of loyalty, and because you bind yourself around, and even when you could have left or should have left, you didn't leave, the Lord said, tell him now. And not just now, but what I didn't tell you in your office, Bishop, is the Lord said, your path is going in a different way. it's almost like your life is going to an off-ramp for another freeway. There are a lot of people that are not going with you because you are a different kind of steward. You're not a steward for name or recognition or preaching opportunities. God knows you've preached as much as you ever wanted to preach. The Lord said, now it's to father, it's to mentor, and it is to set right. It is apostolic, it is order, it is organization. You see, you can't have an apostolic church without having order. And so the Lord says, that's why you've had this insatiable appetite for education. That's why you keep going. That's why you lay the book down and say, you know what? I'm going back. I'm doing more. And you keep doing it because the Lord says, I've got more for you. And there are not hundreds. Listen to me clearly. Hear the word of the Lord. There are thousands. There are thousands whose voices are at the margin. Others have not heard them. Others have ignored them. The Lord said, not you. Not you. So the Lord said, this thing was not the devil. It was me. It was me. Which is why your spirit was settled when you had to make transition. So the Lord said, go. Go. And you know, I hear the word of the Lord say that there was a time you counted things in excess. Y'all always had more than. He said, that day is coming back around. Don't you fool yourself. That day is coming back around. But I want to tell you what made that day come around. Hear me clearly. Hear this. What made that day come back around is you discerned it was time to shift your lifestyle. And when you shifted your lifestyle, because you made the sacrifice, the Lord said, I'm going to do for you what I did for Solomon. There's some people who keep consuming, and the more they consume, the more God say, you still ain't got the lesson. The both of you said, we're giving up this lifestyle. We're reducing consumption. We're reducing the stuff. And the Lord said, now I'm letting the excess come. Hashanda, I'm letting the excess come back. I want to say one more thing to you, pastorally. You'll come, doctor, will you come, doctor? I want to say one more thing to you pastorally, and I want to say it to the both of you. The word of the Lord to you tonight is this, that just like in Ezekiel 47, there were waters that flowed under the threshold of the temple. They flowed down the En-Gedi all the way down to the Dead Sea. And the scripture says there were fruit trees on both sides of the river, and everything in the Dead Sea lived. The Lord said, I'm returning such favor to this church that anybody's connected to this church, the water that flows from this church is going to flow to their homes, flow to their marriages, flow to their families, flow to their businesses. There's some people who got off track and they've been trying to get back on track, but they can't get their lips to say it. The Lord said, I'm going to move the track closer to them. Hashanda, Miko Sabani, Ratanama. God said, I'm going to move the track closer to them. They get ready to get on track. By the time there is a reassemblage of our churches, God is going to give you excess. Excess. Numbers is not where your head is. You're not at numbers anymore. And the Lord says, that's why I can increase these numbers. You're not there yet. So dream bigger. Because you're going to have to fund some of these that you father. You're going to have to fund some of the ones that you father that didn't come out of this church, but they found you. And they said, you, Papa, you. Where do you go? There. Come here. Let's go. And you are. Come stand behind your parents. Come stand behind me.
The strength of my life.
Just stand right behind me. Stand behind me. Look at me. The mantle. The mantle. Has fallen. It to you. Increased capacity. Physically, every place where you think you're at the top, you're getting ready to experience a double grace. A double is coming on you.
And whatever you said I'm not doing, the Lord says I'm changing that tonight because you are going to. Because you can't have this mantle if you don't do. And the Lord say, this mantle belongs to you. It belongs to you from succession. It belongs to you from lineage. But it belongs to you because it was prepared for you. You're going to get it all. You're going to get it all. And you are good enough. You are. I looked at you tonight and I heard the Lord say, tell her, you are. Ah! You are good enough. You are good enough. For where God's taking him, he's taking you. You are good enough. The devil transference of mantle. Devil. And the little girl that got interrupted, God said, I'm going to put her back together. The little girl, like it's like a girl got interrupted. Oh, early teenish, early. God said, I'm putting her. Putting back together. I'm pumping life. Hang on. Would you lift your hands up? This one right here in the black shirt. When I stood next to you, the Lord said, tell her I'm hitting reset over her life. I'm hitting reset. So forget everything that has happened, every mistake, every fault, every failure, every trick, every tempest, every struggle. God said, forget it. I just hit reset. And not only are you good enough, but you're going to have your hands in multiple pots. You're going to have, it's almost like, God's going to let there be three rivers running into your life. You're brilliant. You got capacity. You got energy. You have brilliance. God's going to let it happen to you. But this union will have multiple raging rivers. Impact, influence, income. Shanda.
If you would stretch your hands towards the stage in faith. Come on, lift your worship with us tonight. And you are the source of my strength. Jesus, tonight, you are the very strength of my life.
I want to say, I'm going to say one more thing to you, little sister. Would you come here? Just stand right here. Yeah, the little sister right there. Come. Stand right here. So, what reset means is you won't have to fight off where you came from and the stuff that has come with it. Now the Lord says it'll never have impact or influence in your life. You are going home a different woman. You're going home. Somebody with a different impact. You're going home. Somebody that's got a different understanding. And the Lord will continue to unfold your reset. So between now, oh goodness, and June, you'll see it. You'll experience the fullness of it. And it shall be in Jesus' name. Here's what I want to ask everybody to do tonight. So I want to ask everybody, listen to me carefully. Listen. I was asking the Lord, what's the assignment? And the Lord began to share with me this. But tonight, when Dr. Tony was talking about prayer, it confirmed what I wanted to preach. When Bishop was talking about giving, it confirmed my assignment. It's just one gift. Everybody watching me, go to the Grace Church Ministry app. Go to your mobile app. Go to Grace Church 121. But listen, that 121 is for you.
121 is for you. We're going to give 121 tonight to you. 121. So you get 121 or get as close as you can to it, and we're giving it to him. I want to start.
To you, and tonight we lift our hands and we say, you are the source.
I want to invite you, if you want to give it in cash, give it. You want to write him a check, write it. But if you go to the mobile app, they can do give you a love offering on the mobile app. Cash App, it. Where's that? Tell me that Cash App. $JEA. $JEA. Do it. Now, it could be 121. It could be 21. But whatever it is, this special offering is for him. That's what I heard the Lord say. Let me be obedient for him. If you've got a mobile app, you've got a mobile device, you can go to the app. $JEA. That's tonight. That's tonight what we're going to give tonight. Those of you that are watching, do it now. Don't wait. $JEA. Cash App. Do it now. Those of you who are sparsely situated here in the sanctuary, make this a priority tonight. You'll do it. Come on, my sister, if you want to give, bring it right to him. He wants to bless it. He wants to bless it. If there's anybody else that physically want to give it, you're welcome to come. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The reinvention of Tony is what I hear the Lord say. The reinvention. God, in 2021, God gave you a pause in 2020. 2021, there's the reinvention. Because there's so many more miles of ministry you gotta do. There's so much. I was looking at your book in my office, Harmonize Your Life. You've hit that frequency now. Now, the next half is your best half. The next half is a wiser half. The next half is a deeper half. Deeper roots. More dynamic intimacy. More dynamic connections. And where you've seen yourself go, but the days slipped past and you didn't get there, the Lord said, I held those things too. So this next half, you'll fulfill them. If you were to take your first half of ministry, woman of God, and you were to compress it, you could do all of that in a smaller amount of time. That's what you're getting ready to do now. The Lord said, I'm going to give you, you're going to have energy. You're going to have motivation. You're going to have drive. You're going to have focus. All over Western Europe, too. All over Western Europe. It belongs to you all over. They're looking for you. They're looking for your voice. They got to hear your voice. And the Lord says, don't worry about home. I got everything you've prayed for, everything you asked me. I got it. I got it. I got mom and siblings. I got it. Let that rest now. I got it. I heard you the first time. I heard you. Father, I thank you tonight for the word. Thank you for the offering. Thank you for this church. Thank you for the ministry. Do for this church what you have said in prophecy. In Jesus' name. Amen.
You are the source of my strength.
on, let's lift it real big. Lift it to a God that receives the total praise. Say, you are.
You are the source of my strength.
With a yielded heart and lifted hands, peace.
You are the strength of my life.
I lift my hands.
I lift my hands.
Come on, let's sing it one more time.
On the live stream, you are dismissed into the presence and the power of God. Amen. Amen.
This is Bishop Jonathan Alvarado. I'm here with my wife,
Dr. Tony Alvarado.
And we have a special invitation that we want to make to you today.
Listen, we want you to subscribe to and share the GCI podcast.
Yeah.
Every Monday, there's a new message released on our podcast from either Bishop Alvarado's preaching or the message that I have preached.
Absolutely. These messages will uplift you, they'll instruct you, they'll encourage you to righteousness and to good works. So make sure that you avail yourself to the GCI podcast. Subscribe
and share.
because there is no place
like total grace.